Startup and analyzing data to help improve pediatric care outcomes. And before that, I've worked with online advertising and remote sensing and market research. So lots of different data applications. And the way that I first encountered PCA was back when I was doing my thesis, PhD thesis in statistics. And so my thesis extends PCA, and so having, you know, done the work for it, I kind of, you know, got familiar with what it is, and so hopefully I'll give you a fairly good introduction of what it is today. So we have, what I'll go through is, you know, why PCA, what is it, you know, give you a brief overview, we'll talk about the methodology in depth, and then I have two examples for you, and then we'll talk about just where do we go from here. And so let's start. So you saw probably on the website that the only requirements are that you know what a matrix is, and hopefully you've heard of an eigenvalue. That's about it. So hopefully I'll walk you through the rest of it. I try to make the examples and the R in Python code will give you 99%. The pictures will look exactly the same, but in this talk I'm going to give you examples from R, only because I'm using NIDR to try to make this talk easy. So the only packages that you need in R right here, and there are a couple in Python that you'll need to run these examples. And feel free, if there are any questions, to stop me in the middle and we'll go through that. So if I were to tell you that principal component analysis is the most commonly used dimension reduction technique, I should probably start with, well, what's a dimension reduction technique? So if you have your data set, if this is your data set with N, say N patients and N vital signs, you want to see what are the three ways that we can reduce the dimensionality. So either we can reduce the number of variables, so the number of columns, so that's the second example here, or we can reduce the number of rows, or we can reduce both the rows and columns. And in this tutorial, I'm going to go through actually the second example, that reducing the dimensionality of columns of our data set. Does that make sense? So then, now that we know that we're going to reduce the columns, why do we even want to do that? And so, either you have just too many variables to look at, or your variables are, there's some noise, or some variables are exactly very, very similar to other ones, or you just want to look for patterns. And a reason why we might want to do that, or why do we, you know, how are we going to use this data later, is either standalone analysis, you're doing the principal components, uncovering the patterns, and you're done, you're interested in the patterns. Or you're using the principal components, reducing the dimensionality, and then throwing that into a regression or clustering or something like that. So let me give you some more information about dimension reduction. So I think of dimension reduction as two different types. One is we directly observe what's going on in the data. And so the example here is we were asked, say we're, you know, we're a market research company and we're asking people, okay, you have fruit, tell me how tasty the fruit is or how difficult it is to get to the fruit for eating. Then what you do is you plot the two variables and you're done. Then you, you know, then you can analyze the data. The other way that you can have this, what I call the data generating process, or where the data is coming from, is you haven't observed the process directly. So what that is the market research company will, instead of asking you two questions, will ask you 30 questions about, okay, what's the sugar content, what's the quality of fruit that you get, things like that. And then what you do is you look at the data, try to process it, and then get these two hidden variables that are then can be interpreted as these are tasty fruit or these are difficult to open. So completely different processes. And for this talk, I'll focus on assuming that we're in the second case where we're not directly observing what's going on and we're trying to figure out how what's behind the data. Any questions so far? So now that, you know, hopefully I'm giving you a little bit of an overview of where we're going, now I'll talk about principal components. So what are a couple of assumptions about principal components to start with? And these will be key in terms of when we talk about the extensions of where to go from here. So first, and we'll see this as I go through the methodology, hopefully I'll be able to verify that these, in fact, are the assumptions, is that the variables that we observe, they're going to be linear combinations. So we'll see what that is we'll take 0.5 of one variable, 0.2 of another. There's no 0.5 of the first variable squared and things like that. So that's what we mean by linear. And if you know, all you need to know about your data is the means of variances, and we should be able to explain the information that's in there. And another key assumption is, so if the goal of principal components, and I'll mention this again, is that we want to explain the variance in our data set. So then what we need to make sure is that the variances of our variables are very similar, because if that's not the case, the variables with the highest variance are going to dominate the results, and they'll seem important even though they're actually not. And then the results of principal components are unique up to sign. So what that means is if you're using two different software, as we'll see here, R and Python, R might give you the one version of the components, and Python might say for some of them they're going to be up to a negative one or a positive one. So we'll see, but the results are pretty much the same, and the permutation just means if you change the order of the columns of the weights, the answers are still the same. And hopefully it'll make more sense as we go through the tutorial, but this is kind of an overview of where things are going. So I promise the next 4 or 5 slides are going to be the most dense, but hopefully I'll still give you an introduction of what's going on. So I'll assume that our data has, so say we have M patients and then M vital signs. And what we're trying to figure out, for instance, is what is, you know, the diagnoses or pseudo-diagnoses, what's driving the heart rate and blood pressure. And then the variables themselves have this variance-covariance matrix. And what we're going to try to find are these components Y. And so what you can see is we're looking for these weights that say if we multiply each of the variables in our data set, we're going to have this hidden component. And that's all we need to know, or that's all that we need. As soon as we find the weights, we've already solved and found the, uncovered the hidden patterns in the data. So we saw here that these are just, linear combinations, and this is, just summarizing the thing in matrix notation. So as I mentioned before, the principal components only explain the variance. So all that we're interested in this case is what's the variance of the components. And another assumption is that different components are uncorrelated. So that's what the zero means. So if we're looking at, we have two different components and we're trying to find the covariance, it's zero. So one component is uncorrelated from the other one. And if we're looking for weight, so I said that we're trying to explain, maximizing the variance of our data. One way to maximize it is, okay, well, the weights are infinity, then you've actually maximized it, but that's not very important. So what we want to do is we want to set some constraints. And if we set the constraints of our weight vectors to be one, then we can actually try to do an optimization and solve for these weights. So before we go further, I wanted to give more of a background of what is this multiplication doing. So we have the weights, the covariance matrix, and we have the weights again. So if you start with two vectors, then what the weights do is first they rotate the component, rotate our data. Then what the sigma does is it rescales them, so stretches it out, and then we rotate them again. So that's kind of what this decomposition is doing. And so after we've done that, then in this case, these should be now uncorrelated. Any questions?
That's a good slide. I've seen those formulas before, but that makes it much more intuitive.
And then now hopefully we know what we're looking for. Now we can go through a little bit more math. So these are only hopefully going to be the last 2 slides of math. So as I mentioned, since we're doing an optimization, one way to do that is with, optimization with constraints makes me think of Lagrangian. And so what we have to do is we know that you know, this is the first quantity, this is the quantity that we're constraining, and expanding this out, you know, we get the same thing just with Malin's vectors. And so what we can do is, since we're solving for the v's, which are the unknowns, if we take the derivative, set it to zero, and rearrange the terms, we get this. And one of the reasons why I made the claim I wanted you to hear about eigenvalues, because if you think of this, then you might think about characteristics polynomial and the roots of this being the lambdas. So in this case, then what the solution is going to be is that we can assume that the way that we can solve for these are going to be the eigenvectors associated with the covariance matrix. So now that we know that, or I've at least hopefully kind of convinced you, we'll know that with the singular value decomposition, we get the lambdas, which are the results are in decreasing order. So the first one's the largest, and the second is second largest, and so on. So in our case, because we're maximizing the variance, if we only needed to find one component, we just need to find the vectors associated with the largest eigenvalue. And if we wanted to find a two-component solution, then we just take those vectors associated with the two largest eigenvalues. And then I'll show you more examples with the data of, you know, how do we choose? Because the next question could be, well, how do I know? What do I need to choose? Is it two or three or four, so on. So one of the ways is, you know, we can, potentially we can keep all of the components, but then we haven't reduced any dimensionality. So what we have to figure out is how small of the set we want to keep. And one way to do that, or one way that we can figure out, is by looking at this fraction. So what this says is, we know that each lambda explains a percentage of the variance, and we can calculate what that percent is, and then there's some criteria for figuring out, you know, different rules of thumb of when do we cut, or when do we figure out how many to keep. And so usually what we say is, after we figured out, you know, after we've done the decomposition, we can either say, okay, I think I want to explain at least 80% of the variance. And then you can look at your eigenvalues and see, okay, since I picked that, this is the number that I choose. Another way is to, I'll show you what a scree plot is and we can walk through it, is you plot it and look for where's an elbow. And hopefully one occurs, and then you can choose the component that corresponds to that elbow. Or you can say, for instance, sometimes, you know, like the, you know, regression n is 30, so this is the, you know, for doing some testing, so this is, okay, well, if your eigenvalues explain more than 5%, you might want to keep it. But I think slightly better criteria is to see if the percentage is 1 over the number of variables. If it's bigger than that, then you might want to keep it. So why is that? So, for instance, if you have 10 variables in your original data set, and your component explains 5%, you're actually doing worse than your original variable. So your original variable explained 10%, but your component, your say top component explained 5. So you don't want to do, you know, you would have wanted to keep it here, but I would just say then use your original data set for some other analysis. And then there are some other, you know, if you want to do cross-validation, figure out the optimal one, and a handful of others. So these are just, you know, kind of the most commonly used methods. And for this talk, I think I will focus on the first two, and then talk about the fourth criteria as well.
What I like most so far is the two tutorial sessions we had today. That was awesome. The way the next topics and conference topics are organized.
There is so much to learn, and in this field, and I have been attending data camps, I think every year in the past for the last 2 or 3 years, there's so much new stuff, and these presentations are a quick and easy way for me to find out in 1 hour something new that I need to go study. That's what I do follow up later.
Standard variance summary that you'd expect for an aggression model. So the important thing to know here is that the way R is set up, there's some generic functions that know how to deal, they have methods for dealing with different kinds of input. So R is not a typed language, you don't have to declare types right away. It's very flexible. Sometimes it surprises you with what it calls.
But there is more to it. So anyways, we got it down to say 8 to 12 clusters, roughly. And the first process was more by hand, but then we also wanted to make sure that we could repeat this process easily 5 to 15 times. Now, on the attrition model, so we had one that's an attrition model where this side is very likely to dry. And the profit
What is important now that similarity is common substructure. Can you give an example? What would be, how can in a similar way you do similarity between a dog and a cat? How do you measure? So numbers is obviously. Yes?
Well, one way is if a dog and cat have similar neighbors, okay, over the statistical thing, then they'll be more likely to be similar.
Yeah, so maybe you can like categorical approach. It doesn't matter who you are. It does matter who your connections are. So you just open
the this connects. I talk about spatial tempo.
Okay. For example, let me give you an example.
Spatial tempo.
But maybe particular phrase like how about we have a two
and look at simple data. Historically, Team A against Team B. What are the scores and all? Mm-hmm. And I came up with some magic, whatever, and I decided that team one and two were going to be within 5% of each other. I couldn't tell which one was going to be first and which one is going to be second. And which one was third?
Fine-grained data, but you could say coarse-grained data.
So my thinking was there is so much noise in the fine-grained data that it's extremely difficult to trick it out. If you look at the bigger picture, it's just
all you're saying is I may have all this data, but it's really only a handful that really matter.
Some are critical. That's why I was thinking that I'm not willing to pay to know all the situational data that they have.
But see, that's the difference. That's what I was trying to explain, is that even like if you look at a couple of these sites, right, they have different tiers of the amount of data they're going to give you. It's not just like you open Spigot and you've got the fireworks, right? It's actually different levels. Like there's one of the office sites that I was just going to have, they have like a basic
going, there's so many different examples now, but streaming is obviously, if you're dealing with, who did I see talking about this? Oh yeah, NASCAR apparently had some really interesting project where you could see the metrics of the cars, like RPMs and all this kind of stuff, like happening in real time, as you're sitting.
I wish I could remember his name, because he really does deserve to have his name put out there, but he was like, I've been doing this stuff for years. But that kind of attitude kind of prevented him from like taking advantage of the new wave, right? Yeah, but he said, oh my gosh, all these
people. We're using R and Python. And so the goal there is we are working with different teams. So the advantage for my company, which is really small, is that we're working together with engineers and, you know, there's kind of structure in place for getting the data so that the analytics team is working more on
data engineer, algorithm specialist, business analyst.
At this point, you've got to be able to code in Scala. And
why is that?
Why is that? Actually, you know, I was wondering about that myself as I made notes about what I was learning in each of these last 3-4 years or so. And you're absolutely right that 3 years ago, I never thought of Scala in relationship to what was the data on the data entities. And so what you have to be doing is thinking about, you've got these RDDs, which are representations of your data. And then there's a set of things you can do on an RDD, about 12 to 14 fundamental operations. And those fundamental operations are really the fundamental things you can do in Scala lists.
And the two people who, I guess, Jeffries proposed a bunch of methods in the 30s, the BIC criteria, the BIC criteria, was proposed by Schwartz, I think, sometime in the 70s. And the best paper I know is by Cass. And
is not defined. There is one other use, special case use for null. Joe talked about a lot of functions, how to write functions, and functions will return. Sometimes the function will either have an error or it doesn't know what to return. In those cases, null is typically, by convention, we will just return null. Therefore, when you're calling a function, we call you
decision jungle, and also multi-class, multi-class neural networks. So the very first algorithm I'm going to put is just I'm going to basically get the decision jungle, drop it up here, connect, and something is missing.
As a visiting scholar from Italy with a program which is connected with a Fulbright scholarship, and in my home university in Italy, I do take care of a project which is involved in brand monitoring. And for doing brand monitoring properly, you must, as the first, collect data from the internet. As the second, you must analyze them. So you actually need to fuse those data in a few key parameters, a few key indicators, which can let you understand what's the understanding of the online audience about your brand. And of course, how can you achieve better results with it. And so I think that
specific topic covered in the data camp that makes it specifically attractive for you?
And it's not specifically covered, but I did find a few tools which could be used for this purpose, which were covered in the event.
And which tools specifically were interest for you?
Well, the main ones I'm interested in is semantic analysis, contagion models, and say machine learning in general.
My personal experience is having interviewed people is that I don't see
it's
that.
And
seeing that, especially when I saw it at the last person that we hired.
And making most of the money here. So we're going to just follow this path in the next 2 hours, fast data, big data analytics, and deep insights. So we'll go through each component and we'll talk about that.
So I would consider the biggest source of data is the human body itself, right? I mean, the DNA sequencing, the genome. I think that would be really big data. So applying data science to that.
The most interesting thing about the data camp to go through?
Learning about R.
Learning about R? Yeah. Tell me more about it. Why do you think R is important?
Well, I recently just graduated with a master's in stats, so I'm trying to learn R just to learn how to program and work with data sets.
Why do you think data camp is the best place to start looking into R?
There's a lot of knowledgeable people here. And there's some good information, so yeah, I took a lot of notes, it was good.
I have been to this data camp many times. It's very valuable. It's sort of keeping aware of what people know about in this industry, learning the new things that are happening, and you gotta do that.